Building your own personal brand is critical to being a top producer influencer. You always want to mesmerize your audience. Open with a hook.
So guys, I'm going out today. Yellow's back in style and I'm ready to go.
What are you doing? You are grounded. You are not going anywhere.
Ma!
Listen to your followers.
Hey guys, so you recommended that I try this new blush. So we're going to be doing that today. Oh my gosh, blends like a dream. Highly recommend.
Frick. Oh my, get it off.
Be authentic.
Yo, what's up, YouTube? Just flew into Cabo San Lucas. Be sure to like and subscribe. Happy to be here.
Most of all, serve a purpose.
Hey guys, as you know, health is super important. So try my jalapeno asparagus smoothie recipe, linked in my bio. Ew!
And that's how you build your brand.
Good morning. My name is Aaron. I am one of the pastors here at Ocean View, and I am so glad that you are with us today, worshiping with us. Whether you're online or in the room, I think that God has something for us today that, if we allow it to, can actually shape us and change us. When I was 22, 23 years old, my friend and I, my friend's name is Chad, he and I had been friends for about 6 years. At this point, we decided that we would go to Florida and just have like a vacation for a while. Like that, we just needed a break from school stuff. And we're like, let's go. And so that's what we decided to. Now, before I go any further with the story, you need to know that he and I are still friends to this day. Okay, that's important. We've been friends for 20 years. So whatever happens here is good. So anyway, we go to Florida and we decide that one night we're like, let's go to the movies. Like, let's go. We'll just chill. It'll be fine. So we go to a movie, and here's the thing about me. I love going to movies. I love watching movies. I'm an analytical kind of mind. I was an English major, so I'm always looking at themes and things running through movies and that kind of stuff. And so I went into this movie knowing the premise and having very low expectations of this movie, okay? And I am happy to report that those expectations were met, like right on point, very low. I left that movie being like, that was dumb. That was the dumbest movie I have seen in a very long time. It's so dumb, I'm not even going to tell you what movie it was because I would be embarrassed to tell you. All right, so it's really dumb. Now, we leave, and as people do when they go to the movies, like, what did you think? So we're talking about it as we're leaving the theater, and he brings up his opinion of the movie, and he pointed out some of the things that he really enjoyed about it. And I proceeded to tell him why he was wrong. Every possible way. Everything that he liked, I was like, no, here's why that's wrong. It's not good because da da da. And I had no problem expressing my opinion and distaste for this movie. It's just that as I was doing that, I also may have inadvertently expressed my distaste for his opinion and therefore him. Of the movie. Like the movie was dumb and therefore his thoughts were dumb and therefore he is dumb because he liked this movie. That's the way in which I expressed myself. He proceeded then to tell me exactly what he thought of me in that moment. And in a very unfiltered kind of way, he expressed to me how I tend to have opinions that belittle other people. And it became like this big argument, like right there as we're leaving, to the point that I literally did not speak for the next 3 hours to him. Not one word did I speak to him because I was so taken aback by what he had expressed. Now, what he had expressed was simply pointing out to me something that was a blind spot in my life that I enjoyed sharing my opinion and also letting you know that you were wrong about yours. Like, I have no problem expressing my opinion of letting you know that I'm right. Like, that was his point. And he was pointing that out to me in a way that maybe could have been pointed out differently, but it took him like kind of smacking me. We still laugh about that moment to this day, but it took that moment to kind of make me realize, okay, maybe I have a blind spot in my life. And it wasn't settled in that moment. Years later, I started a job at my first church up in Raleigh, and my mentor there, he made a point to tell me many times, he's like, you are very passionate in what you think. And that is a very gracious way for someone to tell you, you need to be quiet. And so he would tell me that nearly every week. I remember so vividly being in his office. It was like getting sent to the principal's office every week. He's saying, hey, you need to seek first to understand. You need to not share what you think. You're not always right. And that's still something that I work on. Like that is a spot for me that is a temptation for me to just tell you what I think and for me to like keep my mouth shut. And that's a real thing that I struggle with. There were two psychologists back about 70 years ago that joined together, and they kind of came up with this tool to kind of help us identify some things in our lives. Now, when I show you this, I recommend that you do not use this on your friends, coworkers, family, spouse. Deal? That's the deal. Don't take this home and be like, here's what I think. Here's what it is. It's called the Johari window, and I find this fascinating. I read about this many years ago. And it's this idea that there are certain quadrants in our life that form this window, and we don't always have a full picture of ourselves. But if we were to throw a bunch of descriptors, adjectives, up on a board, and you could have other people kind of assign things to you, and you would assign things to yourself, they would fall into one of these four quadrants. There are things that you know about yourself that other people also know. That is like the open self. Everybody knows this about me. I know it about myself. Like maybe you're really funny. Everybody knows you're funny. You know you're funny. You're funny. We got it, okay? That would be a thing. Then there's this other quadrant where everybody knows this about you, but you don't see it in yourself. That was what Chad and Mark were trying to tell me. I had a blind spot in my life where I was just very opinionated and sharing it, and everybody knew it, but no one had told me, right? So I didn't know that about myself. Then there's this other quadrant here where I don't know it. I'm sorry, that I have things that I know about myself, but other people don't know. And we all have that, right? It could be a hidden talent. It doesn't necessarily have to be a bad thing. It could be a hidden talent. It could also be maybe something in our past. It could be something embarrassing that we don't want other people to know. So we have things in our lives that we know that nobody else knows. And then there's this fourth quadrant, and that's unknown to myself and unknown to other people, either because we haven't experienced it yet. I haven't been put in a position to exercise that gifting in that way. There are things that are just hidden to us, all right? So when we look at that, the idea there is that in order to understand ourselves better, as we're talking about building our brand, we really need to recognize more of a complete picture of who we are. Blind spots and all, things in our life that might trip us up. We need to see ourselves through a fuller picture. We're talking about this idea of building our brand, and Pastor Terry really set us up great for this conversation over the next several weeks. We're looking at the letter of James, the half-brother of Jesus, for some really practical ideas on how we can build not our brand, but the brand that Jesus wants to build in our lives. It's really his brand through us. So we made an assumption that you might be a follower of Jesus, all right? That's the assumption in which we're operating today. Now, if you are not a follower of Jesus, maybe you're still in that decision-making process or it's brand new to you or whatever, I just want you to know that if you're not a follower of Jesus, you're going to understand a little bit more today as to why you might be skeptical of people who are followers of Jesus and maybe why people view followers of Jesus as hypocrites and judgmental. We're going to see all of that today. So we started looking at the book of James, and Pastor Terry told us about how trials can be used in our lives to build our faith. In fact, trials in our lives are by design there to strengthen our faith. That's the whole premise there, is that God will allow things in our life that he will then use to strengthen us, to persevere through. But then James makes a pivot, and he starts talking about temptation. Now, we don't like that word a lot, but we're going to get real with it today. Temptations, you understand, are different than trials. Temptations, as we'll see, are designed not to strengthen our faith, but to actually halt our faith. That's not to say that our faith can't be strengthened when we overcome a temptation. It just means that by their natural design, that they are designed to halt our faith or to propel us even further back. This is what James had to say about it. He says this, when tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me, for God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. But each person is tempted when they are dragged away by their own evil desire and enticed. I love these two words here, and they stand out to me in a really radical way. The idea that sometimes we each have our own temptation. Sometimes we like to make a blanket statement about temptation, about things in our lives that trip us up, but you understand that what's a temptation for me may not be a temptation for you. When you see me struggle with something and it's so foreign to you, you have no concept as to why that's a temptation for me, you understand also that at the same time, there might be something in your life that is a struggle for you or that trips you up, and I have no concept of that whatsoever. Because we each person is tempted when they are dragged away by their own evil desire. That's important to know, because sometimes we fall into a trap where we compare our thing to somebody else's thing and we say, oh, my thing's not as bad as their thing, so therefore I'm okay. But we each have our own temptation. We each have our own desire that creeps in. And the desire itself is not necessarily the sin, but it's what we do with it. Notice what he says. Then after desire has conceived, that means when we marry ourselves to that desire, when we agree with that desire or that lust or that temptation, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it's full grown, gives birth to death. The idea that Paul also said that the wages of sin, the price of sin in our life is death, that ultimately when we align ourselves with the temptation or the thing that might trip us up, whether it's this compulsive desire to lie or to steal or to dismiss or maybe hide or whatever it might be for us, again, some are bigger than others in our minds, that sometimes we have this desire that when we align ourselves with it, it actually births death ultimately. That's what happens to us. So what do we do with that? We each have our own temptation, our own thing that could trip us up. He goes on to say, hey, listen, don't be deceived, my dear brothers and sisters. He says this a lot. Dear followers of Jesus, don't be deceived. Every good and perfect gift is from above. Remember, God is not the one bringing those temptations into our life. He is not letting evil into our life. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. That's important imagery. Remember that. He chose to give us birth through the word of truth, that we might be a kind of first fruits of all he created. There's these two ideas. The idea that one, when we align ourselves with our desire, it gives birth to sin. But yet, when we align ourselves with the word of truth, it gives us birth to be a first fruit of creation, a new creation, as Paul describes, that is completely different than our old self. A first fruit of a new creation. The idea of every good and perfect gift coming down from the Father of heavenly lights, and he does not shift like shadows. That is an important thing to remember, because sometimes in my mind, when I look at my temptations or my trip ups, my sin in my life, I think, well, you know what? I'm going to hide behind this veil of a shifting shadow because maybe opinions have changed, or maybe culture has shifted, or maybe it's not as bad as, and these are shadows that kind of move around in my life and really block the light from God from really shining through. If you go back to that idea that our self is made up of this window, of these quadrants, you understand that what God wants to do is shine a light through every single part of our life. What is known, what is unknown to us, what is known to others, our blind spots. God wants to take a light and just shine it through everything. His truth doesn't change based on what we think we know. His truth is what it is, and he wants to do something in us and through us. And maybe we haven't even considered what that is yet. James went on to say this in chapter 1. My dear brothers and sisters, followers of Jesus, take note of this. Everyone, let's pause there for just a second. Everyone, everybody say everyone. All right, that means everyone. Whereas first he talked about we each have our own kind of thing, then maybe yours is different than mine, but we're going to level the playing field. Lest you think that you got it all together, here's something that trips everybody up. Are you ready? Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry, because human anger does not produce the righteousness, it doesn't produce the fruit in our lives that God desires. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, and get this, humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. That idea that the word is planted, as you understand, words are very powerful. It is through words that God spoke the entire universe into existence. It is words that give us life. It's words that can also destroy us. Pastor Terry's going to talk more about words in a few weeks because James has more to say about that. But this idea that there's words of truth that can be planted into our life that can do something more in us if we would align ourselves with that. Now, I told you, sometimes we have an idea that we think we have it all together. Paul thought that way too. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, Paul gave us a little bit of a warning. He says, if you think you're standing firm, if you think you got it all figured out, if you think that you're quick to listen, if you think that what we're saying doesn't apply to you, be careful that you don't fall. In other words, recognize that even though you think you're standing firm, you could still fall prey to it. Because no temptation has overtaken you except what is common to mankind. Everybody breathe a sigh of relief there. That what you're battling, even though it might be different than someone else, it's common. And God is faithful. That is a promise. Some of us need to hear that today. God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear, but when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can endure it. It's the idea that when we align ourselves not with our own lustful desires, not with the own evil that's in us, not with the things and the oughts that we not to do and this and that. Instead, if we align ourselves with the Spirit of God in us, he is able to make a way out for us so that we won't fall prey to that same temptation again and again or a different one. And that sounds really great in theory, but what does it look like when we get really practical with it? What does that mean? Fortunately, James is smart enough to give us an idea. He says this in James chapter 1, "Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves." You understand that just listening, you can fall prey to self-deception. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like someone who looks at his face in a mirror and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. Think about that for just a moment. But whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they have heard, but what? Doing it, they will be blessed in what they do. Just imagine for a moment looking in the mirror and you fix yourself up or whatever it might be and you walk away and you immediately forget, oh, what did I look like? And you go back and you're like, okay, let me fix this and that. Oh, it's good. And you walk away and then you go back and you do it again. Now, some of you are looking at me right now like you should have gone back to the mirror today. Have you looked at yourself? Some of you had that conversation with your kids today. Did you, or your husband, did you look in the mirror today? Men, you keep your mouths quiet. This is one of those don't speak moments. But listen, that is a crazy image. And when I play it in my mind, it just gets crazier. I had, and still do sometimes in my life, but when I lived by myself in Pittsburgh after college for a while, I was in my own apartment, and there were many, many times where I would have this weird thing where I would go to bed at night, and then as soon as my head hit the pillow, I'd be like, I can't sleep. I don't know if I locked the door. Did I lock the door? Did I turn off the lights? Did I turn off the gas on the stove? Those thoughts would run through my head literally every night, and I would lay down, and I'd have to get up. I'd lock the door. It was already locked. I'd turn off the lights, which were already off, and I'd make sure the stove was off, which was already off, and then I'd go back to bed. And then as soon as my head hit the pillow, I'd get up, and I'd have to do it again. Three or four times sometimes in a night. Like, it was just this weird thing. It was crazy. I couldn't go to sleep, and it drove me nuts that I would do that to myself. I don't do that as much anymore, but what I do, this is the big one, I'll lock my car door. Anybody else do this? I'll lock my car. I will walk all the way through the parking lot to the front of the store, whatever it is, and I'll get to the door, and I'll be like, did I lock my car? And I will have to go all the way back to my car, or I'm doing like this number where I'm hitting the button and holding it, like aiming like it's a laser beam or something. And until I hear that beep, I'm like, okay, it's locked. And I do that all the time. It drives me crazy. It drives my wife crazy because we'll walk all the way through the parking lot and she knows it's coming. She knows, like, did I lock the car? And now she like listens for it to make sure that I do it. But even when she tells me I did, I still go back sometimes. Like, it's this weird thing. You know why that's so frustrating? Because I can't move ahead. I get stuck in a cycle. Like, I have a plan in my mind, but I keep having to go back. And that's what James is saying. He's like, listen, you want to break that temptation in your life? You want to get out of that rut? Then you got to stop just looking for the quick fix in the mirror, walking away and being like, oh, I got to go back. And then going back for the quick fix in the mirror and then walking away and trying to, you get it in a cycle and you can't break it. Instead, we have to look intently and then do and continue in what it says. A friend of mine several years ago was at my church, and he knew that I was a pastor there at the church, and he pulls me aside one day. He's like, let's go have coffee, and he says, hey, I just want you to know that I think I'm going to start looking for a different church. And I said, oh, that's interesting. I said, that's fine. I mean, I want you to go where you can thrive and, you know, feel like you're part of something, but can I just ask why? He says, well, I don't feel like the messages at church are really doing anything for me anymore. And I said, oh, that's interesting. Okay, can you tell me more about that? Like, what do you mean? He's like, well, I just feel like I'm not growing. I feel like I'm not getting much out of it. It's not going deep enough, is what he said, which I always love. And I said, well, can I ask you something? He said, yeah. I said, well, have you spent a lot of time in the Word this week, like on your own? He said, well, you know, a few days. I said, okay, have you mastered everything that was said last Sunday? And he goes, no. I said, oh, okay. What about the Sunday before that? Well, no. I said, okay. So what is it that you're looking for exactly? A mentor of mine asked me this question once, and it resonates with me so much. What do you already know that you're not being obedient to? Sometimes we think we got to find something else. There's more thing. We got to go deeper or whatever. And this was Paul's frustration too when people complained. And he was like, well, I would have given you more, but you're not even doing what I've already told you to do. What do you already know that you're not being obedient to? What's going to break you from going from the mirror and walking away and coming back? You know what the difference is in going back to the same thing and having to learn and repeat the same thing again? You know why you might get frustrated and you feel like you're not growing in your faith? Do you want to know why? James actually tells us, he said, you have to look intently and then continue in it. Jesus said the same thing. He told a story about a sower who was sowing some seed. It was the word of God, and he tells about different places where it lands, but there's only one that stood out. There's only one that actually grew. This is what he said in Luke. But the seed on good soil stands for those with a noble and good heart who what? Hear the word, retain it, and by persevering, produce a crop. No one lights a lamp and hides it in a clay jar or puts it under a bed. That's as crazy as going to the mirror, walking away, and forgetting what you look like. Instead, they put it on a stand. Why? So that those who come in can see the light. For there is nothing hidden that will not be disclosed, and nothing concealed that will not be known or brought out in the open. There's no quadrant of your life that is concealed when God is shining through you. Therefore, consider carefully what? How you listen. Whoever has will be given more. Whoever does not have, even what they think they have, will be taken from them. Jesus tells us, be very careful in how we listen. James is telling us to be quick to listen. So the question is, are you quick to listen or just quickly listening? There is a difference. I want to be quick to listen, and it's hard. It's a struggle for me. To be quick to listen. I often am just quickly listening. Tell me what I need to hear. I'll go do it. I forget. Can you tell me one more time? Okay, great. Can you tell me one more time? Give me the quick fix. I just want to listen quickly. I'm going to keep walking while you're talking. And I'm going to do my thing. Instead, James says something different. He said this, just as a reminder, whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they have heard, but what? Doing it, they will be blessed in what they do. That perfect law that gives freedom, do you want to know what that is? That's an important question to ask. Because if that's what we're supposed to be looking intently into, wouldn't you want like to know like what that is? Do you want to know what that is? That perfect law of freedom is Jesus. It is Jesus himself. It is the Spirit of God in us as his followers. It is the law of freedom, not just freedom from the penalty of sin, but also freedom to righteousness. that gets us out of temptation, that gets us out of the cycle that we might find ourselves in. Paul said as much in 2 Corinthians. He said this, he, being God, has made us competent as ministers of a new covenant. Not of the letter, which was the old covenant, the letter of the law, but this is of the Spirit. For the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life. He goes on to say, now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. It's simply looking intently into what the Spirit of God wants to tell us and listening intently, carefully, and then doing it. Jesus was asked once, what's the greatest commandment like in all of Scripture? Some religious leaders were trying to trick him, trip him up, make him categorize, thought they could do that. And Jesus responded by saying, well, just love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind. And they probably at that point were like, okay, all right, that's pretty good. But then he said, wait, there's a second that's equal to the first. Not second, equal. Love your neighbor as yourself. Love God, love others. That's the law of freedom. And the Spirit is in you to equip you to do that. Everything else rests on those two things, loving God and love others. So when we ask ourselves, how do we break that cycle? Like, how do we know if we're in it? How do we know? Well, James kind of gives us a little bit of a qualifier in this. In chapter 1, verse 26, those who consider themselves religious and yet do not keep a tight rein on their tongues deceive themselves, and their religion is worthless. Religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this, to look after orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. It's like James is saying, hey, listen, your words matter, your actions also matter. Sometimes you may not even need words. Love doesn't necessarily require words. I can love my neighbor as myself without saying a single word because sometimes my words might trip me up. Sometimes my words might say one thing when my heart means something else. This happens without us even thinking about it real sometimes. James actually gives an example that's very practical, even for us today in chapter 2. He lets us know about this. My brothers and sisters, followers of Jesus, believers in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ, must not show favoritism. Suppose a man comes into your meeting wearing a gold ring and fine clothes, and a poor man in filthy old clothes also comes in. If you show special attention to the man wearing fine clothes and say, here's a good seat for you, but say to the poor man, you stand there or sit on the floor by my feet. Have you not discriminated among yourselves and become judges with evil thought? If you really keep the royal law found in Scripture, love your neighbor as yourself, you are doing right. But if you show favoritism, you sin and are convicted by the law as lawbreakers. For whoever keeps the whole law and yet stumbles at just one point is guilty of breaking all of it. Remember, the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life. For he who said you shall not commit adultery also said you shall not murder. If you don't commit adultery, but you do commit murder, you've become either way, doesn't matter, you are a lawbreaker. So what do we do then? Here's what he says. Speak and act as those who are going to be judged by the law that gives freedom. Because judgment without mercy, do you want judgment without mercy? I don't. Will be shown to anyone who has not been merciful. But get this, mercy, I love this, mercy triumphs over judgment. That's an incredible thing. Mercy triumphs over judgment. When we start comparing ourselves to other people, when we start saying we have it all figured out, when we start saying I don't need to hear anything else, I'm good. When we start looking at other people and say, well, at least I'm not as bad as that, and we ignore the blind spots in our life that other people out of mercy are trying to point out to us, or that the Holy Spirit himself is trying to point out to us, we cast judgment on ourselves. And we diminish the work of the Spirit that he wants to do in us and through us. Ultimately, we hinder him. Jesus gave a warning for this in Matthew chapter 7. He said, "Do not judge, or you too will be judged. For in the same way you judge others, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank that's in your own eye?" Don't we do that all the time? We think my thing isn't as bad as their thing, so mine is okay. That is a shifting shadow. That is not the light of God in us, trying to undo all that sin that is in us. Mercy over judgment. So what do we do with all of that? That's loaded. I gotta be real with you for a second. Like, as I've been working through this last couple weeks, like, I'm looking at that, and I'm looking at my own life, and I know that God is shining a light through the window of my heart, and he is looking at my life, and he's looking at all the space. He says, "Listen, I don't want any quadrants. I'm just looking at you as a whole, and I want your spirit to be aligned with my spirit so I can shine through you to produce something, not for myself, but for him." So what do we do with all of that? Well, here's the first one that I'm taking away with this, and it's something that I think we can all do, according to James, is to take inventory of our own sin and repent. And in your mind, you might be thinking, like I have been thinking, "Well, I'm good. There's nothing that stands out to me." Paul and James would say otherwise. There is something, even if it's not known to you, ask Jesus to reveal it to you. Maybe a trusted friend will reveal it to you out of mercy, not judgment. There is always something in us that God wants to root out. We have to look intently. That requires that we be humble, by the way. That our pride falls, that our arrogance goes by the wayside, that we don't think that we have it all together, that we have it better, that we're better than somebody else. But there's a level playing field when we look at Jesus and what he wants to do in us. But it does require us to be humble. Humble to listen. Listening to his word is super important. That we don't keep just looking at it, listening, and then walking away, but that we really look intently, that we're quick to listen, not quickly listening, but we're listening intently to his word, that we're continuing in it by listening to his spirit. That you understand that when we look at it and we walk away, that his spirit is in us, so we don't have to keep going. Like, he wants us to actually effectively live it out in our lives, to produce something in us we haven't even seen yet, that only God knows, who is intimately acquainted with all of our ways. Maybe it means we listen to one another. I'm not saying about the negative voices. I'm talking about people who have relational capital with you, voices you trust that are aligned with the Father, who will speak mercy over judgment to you and point out things to you. It could be somebody in your group. It could be a trusted friend. It could be a counselor. Maybe you need that. That we love one another. Maybe you need to forgive somebody. We don't get to pick and choose who we get to love. Jesus said, "Love your neighbor as yourself." That's it. There's no qualifier to that. You don't get to decide who gets that love and who doesn't. And that includes yourself, by the way. You understand that Jesus came for you. He loves you. Mercy over judgment. That's mercy for yourself, mercy for others through Jesus. So I don't know what your next step is in all of that. I can identify a few in my own life. Just as we each have our own kind of evil desire, each kind of our own temptation, you understand that we each then have our own step to take. And it's going to be different for everyone, but I promise you the step to take is not just to stand still. Be very careful, as Paul said. So we each have a move to make. I don't know what yours is, but you're in a place, if you're new to Ocean View, you're in a place of a community of people that'll walk with you, that hopefully portray mercy over judgment, because it's greater than that. And it's difficult to take a step because it requires that humility. But when you take it, I promise, remember the promise? God is what? Faithful. And he'll see you through it. Will you pray with me, God? In this room, every person, myself, every person has a step to take. Let us not be arrogant to think that we have it all together. Let us not be arrogant to think that we don't need your grace anymore. We're good. God, for all that we know, would we be obedient to it? God, for all that we know, could we actually live it out in a way that shows that we love you and that we love others as much as we love ourselves? And God, for anyone in this room who doesn't love themselves, God, would they meet you and know that they are made in your image and they are worthy of your love? You died for them. God, would you help us to take a step today in relationship with you for those who maybe are on the fence of whether or not they want to follow you because they've seen what judgmental people can do? Would you reveal yourself to them, who you are? God, for those of us who've been following you for a while and maybe we just fall into the trap of thinking we got it figured out and that this isn't for us, these are just words that we get to hear. God, forgive us and then put it to our steps and let us live it out. God, help us to listen to your Spirit, to listen, listen, to listen. Not be so quick to speak. Father, we love you and we know that you are faithful. We trust you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.